morning and welcome to the 2021 UT Dallas Women's Summit. We are so excited to have you all join us for the next 3 days as we enjoy educational workshops and inspiring keynotes. My name is Elaine Renee, and I'm a managing director in the risk division at Goldman Sachs based in Dallas. Goldman Sachs is excited to support the Women's Summit this year, in line with our dual commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion at the firm, and to providing support to entrepreneurs across the country and specifically in Dallas. As I reviewed the summit agenda, it struck me that the topics that will be covered, branding, negotiations, and funding, are critical to the success of small businesses, especially woman-owned and minority-owned small businesses, and directly align with the themes that we at Goldman Sachs have been focused on in our support of small businesses. A few years ago, Goldman Sachs and the Goldman Sachs Foundation launched the 10,000 Small Businesses Initiative to help small businesses in the U.S. create jobs and economic growth by providing entrepreneurs with practical business education, business support services, and access to capital. We're proud to note that to date, 10,000 small businesses has served over 11,700 small businesses across the country. In 2014, 10,000 small businesses committed $20 million to support small businesses in Dallas, and applications for the next 10,000 small businesses cohort are open on our page, gs.com. In 2020, we kicked off Launch with GS, our $1 billion investment strategy grounded in our data-driven thesis that diverse teams drive strong returns. Through Launch with GS, Goldman Sachs aims to increase access to capital and facilitate connections for women, Black, Latinx, and other diverse entrepreneurs and investors. The other theme that struck me in the agenda is the focus on networking. I encourage you all to take full advantage of these opportunities. At Goldman Sachs, we've made a public commitment to aspirational hiring goals of 50% women at the analyst and associate level and 40% women at the vice president level by 2025. However, we know that hiring isn't enough, and to truly drive change, that commitment needs to be maintained. To that end, we leverage inclusion networks to provide ongoing support, networking, professional development, and career advancement opportunities to our diverse professionals. This is a key aspect of our critically important strategy for expanding diversity, equity, and inclusion at the firm. Personally, I've benefited greatly from relationships built via participation in our inclusion networks, and I believe this summit can provide you all with similar opportunities to build your careers and your businesses. So thank you all again for joining us today, and I hope you all enjoy and gain a lot from the summit. To kick off today's program, we will welcome Leah Frazier to teach Getting Publicity for Your Biz, How to Leverage Press and Media for Exposure. Let's hear a little bit more about Leah.
Leah Frazier is a two-time Emmy Award-winning and 10-time Addy Award-winning entrepreneur and was recognized as one of Dallas's most successful women for 2015. She is a multi-licensed attorney turned marketing and communications guru who unapologetically left the practice of law to pursue her entrepreneurial ventures. Leah has built a multifaceted empire as an award-winning journalist, publicist, media personality, digital marketing expert, and in-demand consultant to notable brands. Leah is the CEO and proud owner of Think3 Media, an award-winning creative marketing and communications agency. Please welcome Leah Frazier.
Hello, 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 and welcome to everyone attending for the UTD Women's Summit. I want to thank UTD so much for having me today, and I'm so glad that all of you guys are joining me. I am Leah Frazier, the CEO of Think3 Media. And to kick off today's summit, we will be talking about the fun stuff, press, media, publicity for your brand and business, all the things that business owners and entrepreneurs think about at the last minute. They don't think about it in the beginning. So before we kick it off, I just want to tell you guys to take copious notes. But if in fact you want my slide presentation, I'm more than happy to send it to you. Just email me, leah@think3media.com. I'm going to go through the presentation. And then if you guys have any questions, we'll tackle all those questions at the end. But I'm going to go ahead and kick this thing off and we'll get into the fun stuff. All right. All right, so let's talk about how to garner media and press for your business and your brand. So this is going to be a very brief session, but in this session, we're going to tackle several things like how to gain press and media mentions and why is that important as far as you building your business and your brand and moving forward? Why do you need to leverage these type of relationships and what can it do for your business? And here's the best part. Here's how to get all of this stuff without ever hiring a PR agency. I know I'm taking business for myself. That's like bad business 101, okay? But here, I'm going to tell you how you can do it without hiring a PR agency or a firm ever. So save all your coins, put it into something else, invest it into marketing, social media, interns, all that other stuff. But I'm going to talk PR without the PR price, all right? So a lot of people, why should I listen to you? I'm coined by colleagues as the media maven. I've coordinated a million PR campaigns that I'm extremely proud of. Worked with activist Lauren Leader Chavez. She was mentioned in Forbes. She's one of Fortune's top 50 influential women to follow on Twitter. She's just amazing. I've worked with Hennessy. You've seen Danielle Cerency Jones with Power Hands. She's a UTD favorite. MM LaFleur is an amazing fashion company. I've done several fashion weeks. Just came back from New York Fashion Week representing a designer out of Harlem there. I've represented multiple best-selling authors, have worked with Comerica Bank, Dallas Entrepreneur Center. I'm actually a facilitator here at UTD. So I help to facilitate our Galaxy Women's Entrepreneurship Program. And so I'm very involved, but I've been in PR for a while with clients featured in Black Enterprise, New York Times Travel, WMAG, Cosmopolitan, all the good stuff, you guys. And our assistants with them have helped to increase their sales because they already came with a marketing strategy. And we've increased their awareness and massive expansive efforts as a result of them working directly with us. So I've done a lot of things right getting into this biz. You guys heard from them earlier that, yes, I'm an attorney and I've had very different entrepreneurial ventures, but Think3 Media is my baby and I think I'm gonna stick with it for a while. Done a lot of things right in PR, but I've also done a lot of things wrong. And when people think about press and media, especially for their business, they sometimes intertwine it with marketing. And I want to go ahead and tell you guys right now that if you're a business owner and you want publicity and press and you want to be in the media and you want to do all that fun stuff, you know, you saw the slider video that they had before we came on and you saw Jenny Anchondo, who's now at CW33, and you saw Kelly Raspberry with 106.1 Kiss FM and all of those guys. You have to have a solid marketing strategy aside from your PR strategy. Marketing is the thing that helps you to build trust with your customer, that helps to get the leads for your customers. You take them through this customer journey or this consumer journey, and then all of a sudden they're buying your product or they're trying to do business with you. PR to me is like the icing on the cake, that thing that maybe you've got them through your marketing funnel, you're posting everything on social media, they have a general awareness of you, but PR just amplifies that message even more and takes it to the public in a massive way. So when I talk about a lot of the things that I've done right and a lot of the things I've done wrong, as a business owner, I know for the people that approach Think3 Media, sometimes they don't have things set up all the way and they want to go on TV. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. So you want to make sure that all of your ducks are in a row. You want to make sure that you actually have a marketing plan that can go alongside your PR strategy, because they are both literally like peanut butter and jelly. It's one happy little sandwich. I don't know about you guys, but I like my peanut butter and jelly sandwich with globs of jelly. And if it's just peanut butter, it's sticky and it's not as good. So PR, marketing, hamburger, peanut butter and jelly, all the food. It's around lunchtime. I'm sorry, you guys, you're going to hear a lot of food references. But so over the last 11 years, I have learned that there are very strategic and simple ways for you and your business to earn multiple media and press mentions per month or bi-monthly if you choose. And this can help you to stay consistent and top of mind, especially when you're consistently trying to reach your customer or if you're trying to use press and media to build trust. I know it does something for me if I, you know, if I see a book at Barnes and Noble and it's like, oh, well, she was on the Tamron Hall show, or oh, it's on Oprah's book list. So that's what PR can help you do. It just leverages your brand a little bit to make that trust factor in your marketing a little bit easier when you're building your audience. So Today, we're going to talk two simple ways of thinking about your PR strategy. If you don't have one already, or maybe you already have a PR team, maybe there's some things that you can ask them for the months ahead. And then to feel confident in pitching yourself without feeling self-centered. A lot of people, Leah, I don't like to talk about myself. I'm the founder of my business, but my business speaks for itself and I don't want to be on TV. Well, sorry. Nowadays, people want to actually hear from the founders and they want to build a human connection with the person behind the brand. And it's not you being self-centered. It's you doing everything that you can in your power to reach your target audience. We'll talk a little bit about that. And then these theories that I talked to you about today, you can plug into almost any campaign, whether you're going for your local press or media, or if you have a business or a brand where you think, you know, this deserves to be in Forbes. This deserves a mention in New York Times. I need to be on MSNBC. Whatever it is, we'll talk about some of these theories that can get you plugged in to those local or national campaigns. So I discovered all this the hard way. I went all around the mulberry bush, but today you get to cheat and you're going to get it from me the easy way. All right. So here's the hard way. A lot of people think about press this way. They end up paying thousands for media contact lists. And I'm not here to judge. We're non-judgmental. We're, you know, let's just be positive. But there's a lot of businesses out there that jump the gun and they pay for these press and media list, or they pay for PR software and they don't know what to do with it. And it doesn't have to be like that. You can save that money and use that for hiring, use that for interns, use that for whatever else, but don't dump that into media contact list. Okay. Another way that I see people doing press and media the wrong way when they're first launching a business or brand or trying to get a story out is that they're looking at the quantity of press and media mentions that they gain versus the quality. So you can have, and I've had a client do this, where we got one solid article, and I'm a shout out Dallas Innovates. They were the first person to publish a story, and he reached $100,000 investor. Technically, my job was done. I didn't have to go out for quantity of press and media mentions for him because that one solid mention got him what he was looking for. And that was to be placed in front of an investor that could then give him VC money or whatever he needed for his business. So quantity versus quality. Sometimes if you go out, you talk to a lot of these freelance publicists or PR agencies out there, and they're all about, well, I can get you 10 mentions a month, which they shouldn't say, but they do. You don't want that. You want those quality press mentions that's right in front of your target audience or whoever you need it to be in front of that convert. All right. And we're going to talk about that today. Another thing that I see people go wrong is writing countless press and media releases. I had a client that, I need a media release because, you know, I took my dog for a walk outside, and like they kind of care about that. So I want to save you time in that you don't have to pitch the media every time something monumental happens with your company, but only those milestones that are a super big deal that can convert every single time. And newsflash, you don't have to write a press release about it. Once you build a relationship, you shoot them an email and they'll have you on. All right. And then you have to put time in your schedule. If this is something that you really want for your business, it has to be a part of your business plan. It has to be a part of your week that I'm going to dedicate, and we'll get to this later in the slides. I'm going to dedicate several hours per week in acquiring contacts and putting them in a spreadsheet and then reaching out to them on behalf of the business or the brand to tell our story. A lot of people wait to the last minute. It's the week before your launch. It's the week before the app drops. And then you're trying to reach out to the press and media to cover your story. And you don't know who to contact and you're doing it way too late. So if you do this several hours per week, and we'll talk about this later on in the slides, by the time you're ready to put something out and have it published, you'll be prepared and hopefully you'll be able to convert. All right. So let's get you the simple, easy way that doesn't require you to spend thousands. I know I like to save money. I don't know about you, but I don't want to pay a firm $2,500, $5,000 a month to do something that maybe myself or an intern or a contractor can do that saves me a little bit more money and then gives me a little bit of ROI. So I'm going to tell you about these results. I've had some people that I've taught this to that have gone out and they've they've literally gotten, like 3 or 4 mentions within 30 days. But I want to tell you that PR is not a microwave strategy. This is something that is long term. When we talk about building PR campaigns, you always want your business at the forefront. So if you reach out and they deny your story a couple of times, you cannot throw in the towel and say, I don't want to do this anymore. Or they did so-and-so startup, but they didn't do mine. They told they have so-and-so on as an expert all the time and not me, and I'm a better person. You can't think like that. It's not a microwave mentality. The essence of PR is all about relationships. And when you can build these relationships and you can be solid on giving these contacts a really great story, I promise you, they will call on you every single time you're a fit without you even really having to pitch them. And so we need to think PR long term. It's not a microwave strategy. If you can get that out of your head, you can manage your expectation and you'll have a great road ahead as far as press and media is concerned for your brand or your business. Okay. So 3 short things. We don't have that much time today, but we're going to tackle how to be prepared and how being prepared can lead to more publishings. I'll tip you guys into what's trending right now in PR, as well as what has been affected due to COVID. And so how you can be prepared. It's a whole nother animal how to be prepared now, especially for TV and radio, from what it was before. 2, the secret to attractive media angles. So I'll show you a couple examples of mine where it's like, oh, they saw it and everybody ran the story. And then we'll talk, once you figure out what's my angle, like why should they care? Why should they care about my story? Then you need to figure out how to package it up nicely and pitch it to the media. And you only need a little time per day to make this work. And so we'll dive straight into that. But first, I want to reframe what your thinking is on publicity as a whole, okay? I'm not going to have a little, you know, chatty fest with you guys, but I'm going to keep it 100% real. People come through the door, businesses come through the door with extremely lofty goals. It's like, I want to be on Good Morning America. My startup is the best startup in the world. I want to be on Good Morning America. And if I can't get that, I don't know why. And oh, by the way, I need an interview with Oprah. I need to be on CNN. And I need to be on the cover of like Essence or Cosmopolitan or Women's Health. But haven't had a lick of coverage locally or haven't had anybody locally to care about their story. And on top of that, sometimes some of our non-traditional forms of media, which I'll break down in just a second, is way more effective than going on Good Morning America, which a lot of these shows you guys are pay to play. People pay a lot of money to go on those shows. It's not, some of them are earned, but some aren't. They're paid for. Newsflash. But you have to think of publicity in terms of, it's not about you. It's about, I have a product, a service, a business, whatever it is, and I need to reach my customer, point blank, period. So if your customer doesn't reach or they don't watch Good Morning America, what are you doing? You need to be aiming for the newspaper that they read. You need to be aiming for the podcast that they listen to. You need to be aiming for the influencers that they follow on Instagram on a regular basis. And now the TikTok gurus, shout out to Dresden Goldberg. I'm just saying, she's amazing and she's with UTD and she's killing it. But those are the people you need to be thinking about versus these societal norms that have told you that if you're popular, you're going to go on XYZ show. If you're popular, you're going to go on XYZ radio show. So when people come in, I feel like I'm a therapist. I have to unwind all of this stuff that they have in their mind and say, no, if you trust me, where we place you will work. Okay. So traditional forms of media are only a fraction of a PR plan. So when I say traditional, I mean like broadcast TV here locally, going on Channel 8, Good Morning Texas. Maybe you go midday or daybreak, Good Day Fox, radio stations. You have your Kiss FM. You have DD in the Morning with K104, CW33 with Jenny on Channel. You have all those guys. To me, that's traditional. That traditionally, when we think of press and media, that's what comes top of mind. All right. I now need you guys to reframe your thinking, because now in 2021, some of the top converting forms of media right now is podcast. Because what happened? We went into COVID, and for most of us, or some of us, we stayed home. We didn't have anything else to do but to browse the internet all day. Or that's why Clubhouse got popular, because we were all at home and we logged in a Clubhouse, and Clubhouse was straight audio, and we were listening to panels, and we were listening to the greats like Grant Cardone, you know, tell us how he made his billions. And audio just blew through the roof because of COVID-19. And it's still very effective. So you're going to see a lot of your top business leaders, if you haven't already, when they have PR plans, there is a separate component for a podcast tour. They don't just want to go on the radio and the TV. They know that there is a large audience that listens to podcasts all day. And sometimes if the podcast is smart, the podcast will go from your Apple and Google Play, and they'll convert it to YouTube. So if you go home and you want to watch it visually, then you turn off your phone, you put it on YouTube, and boom, you're interacting with whoever that interviewed guest is. This is the wave of what gets lost when people try to do PR, because they're only focused on traditional. When if you can do a podcast tour for your business, for your brand, and get on the top, I would say make a list of, you know, the top 200 podcasts and just, you know, pitch yourself. You have to think that every single podcast episode gets distributed to at least 10 platforms. So that is 10 different ways your interview is being heard. Most podcasts have a caption. So that's 10 different ways on the internet that your name and your business is being put out on Google, right? SEO, search engine optimization, is important. You want people to find you. And then if you're smart and you tell them, I want you to hyperlink back to my website when you write the caption for my podcast episode. Now you have what we call backlinks. I don't have time to get into it today for SEO purposes, but that is major for you trying to categorize your business on the top pages of Google. You get that with a podcast. It's very hard to get that with broadcast TV, and you ain't getting it with radio. So this is why we have to reframe our thinking. Is Oprah nice? I love Oprah. I want to meet her one day. Is Tamron Hall nice? Tamron's great. I want to meet her one day. But if I'm thinking strategically about getting my small business or my startup found and search engine optimization and all of those great things over time, whatever 200 times 10 is, I think it's 2000. You do 200 podcasts, now you're in 2000 plus pages out there on Google with a hyperlink back to your site. You cannot buy that type of PR, and people are not thinking about that. So I want you guys to think about these non-traditional ways of getting your message out there. Live streaming, like we're doing today on StreamYard. You've got people out there with YouTube shows and YouTube subscriber followings that's much higher than going on TV at 9 o'clock in the morning. Don't at me. It's true. And I can tell you exactly who they are. I would rather my client have a YouTube interview to go on some other television stations. But I love my TV people. But I'm just saying, you do have influencers that convert at a higher level. So you have to think about that. Moving on. So before you decide, I want to be on TV. I want to be on this podcast. I want to be on, you know, whatever, radio. Here are some things you need to properly prep for. The thing that I warned you guys about before is that if you're not prepared, A, you could get a no from who you're reaching out to, or they will drive so much traffic to your business, and if you're not ready, it can shut you down in 2.2 seconds. So here's some things that I want you guys to think about. Before you go and you pitch the press, please check your website and make sure that everything works. I slipped the ball. I'll be quite honest. I dropped the ball a couple of weeks ago on a client we had come through the door. I checked all her websites. She had an additional personal brand website out there that we didn't find. And when we pitched her to TV, one of the TV stations found it and was like, when we pull it up, it's nothing but a bunch of code. And I was like, what are you talking about? And they're like, no, not that site that you sent us. She has a secondary site. And I was like, holy moly. went out there, I text her, and I pretty much was like, you need to fix this today. Otherwise, this segment is gone. Because they will not put their butts on the line for someone or their business that looks a hot mess. Let's just keep it real. So have all your ducks in a row and polish. Make sure all the links on your site work. What you don't want is people excited. Oh, I saw you on Good Morning Texas and I want to buy those fragrances that you came out with. And they click on the link on your site and it doesn't work. Or there's something wrong at checkout. So now they don't trust your site. Now they give you a bad review and it can all go downhill from there just from that one opportunity. So please check everything and make sure it's polished. Have your lead magnet ready to go. This is the number one thing that I see a lot of business owners do wrong if they're doing PR for themselves. And I've even seen some publicists not prep their clients on this as well. There is no way I'm going to have a client go on TV or the radio and not have some sort of call to action. Go to my Instagram bio and get this. Go to Amazon and download my new ebook for blah, blah, blah. Or with a lead magnet, have something for free to give to them just in case you have a high ticket item and you're on TV and they don't want to buy from you yet because they don't trust you. So say, yeah, you know, my new book is out, but if you go to my website and you sign up for blah, 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 I'll give you the first two chapters for free. So have that ready to go before you get on the segment. That's what being prepared is. And that will help you to convert. All right. Then scrub your social media. Having this discussion with someone yesterday that now social media is like the new portfolio for everybody. And so when you're doing PR, that's the first thing they look at. What does their Instagram look like? If you're B2B, are they active on LinkedIn? And the reason why you're going to want to scrub it, obviously, for questionable content. They're not going to have anybody out there that's just like super vulgar and is going to make the station look bad or make the magazine look bad, whatever. But if you are active on social media and they see that you will share it or you have some sort of a following or you have engagement, that makes digital outlets so much more excited to have you on because they know you will drive traffic to your interview. So you have to have that social media popping and you have to show that you're consistent and you're not doing a drive-by like, oh, well, I did my post for January. I'm out of here. See you March. No, that does not work. Okay. All right. Make sure you have plenty of your product in stock. You don't want to go and say my startup is so great. And then you only have three in each item and you sell out. And now people are ticked off at you because you didn't have enough. So be prepared. You need to have a flexible schedule because once you pitch, you have to be prepared that they love your story so much. They'll ask you, can you come on tomorrow at 8? And what you can't do is come back around and say, well, I'm not available tomorrow at 8. I mean, can you do next Wednesday at 9:30? It is not about you. And these people get pitched hundreds of stories a day. So I don't care what you have to do. You have to have a flexible schedule when you reach out and you have to be prepared that they're going to want it on a very quick turnaround, especially if they're looking for a great story. Media companies in Dallas now that have Zoom rooms, I would highly suggest either the Slate, Get Your House Prepped for TV. They have great Zoom rooms, but most of everything is Skype. And it's going to be on Zoom. And for some TV stations, they actually check the speed of your internet. And you have to screenshot it before they'll actually let you come on. So this is why I'm talking about be prepared. And then you're going to need to have a very well-organized press kit. So we're talking about that, what you should have ready to go before you say, put me on TV. All right. So here's the basics of a press kit. You hear people say, oh, and it could be press kit, press folder, whatever. I keep all of my clients' things in Dropbox and the media loves it. And it's very organized. I have a general press release in there that says why I want the story covered. Is it the launch of, you know, a new app? Boom. The press release is in there. Here's the key. You need one in PDF format and another one in Word. And I'm sorry if I have any of my press and media people listening today, but some of you guys, you know, you're lazy. Or sometimes you're not lazy. You just have to crank out like 6 articles a day. So they're not going to want to do an original story. They're just going to copy and paste your press release and click publish, which is fine. We don't care. We just want the story out there, right? But if they don't have that press release in Word, they're going to move on to the next person. So you're going to put that in Word so that they can copy and paste and you make their job easier and they love you for life. All right. Then you put your bio in there. Why? Because sometimes they want to describe who you are. Sometimes they read your bio on air. You just never know. So you need a long one, a short one as well. That's no longer than 150 words. Put that in Dropbox or a Google Drive. You also want your headshots, new headshots, please. Now, I change my hair 50 million times, so I give myself the exception because I don't know what mood I'm going to wake up in and if I want to wear my natural hair or a wig or my natural wig or my curly wig, whatever. If you're like me, just have some headshots that look like you. You know, you don't want to catfish the news people, but have your headshot plus lifestyle images. So when I say lifestyle, I mean images of maybe you outside, or it's maybe you got you and your company people in the, you know, in the conference room, just something that says my startup, my business is fun and we're human beings and not robots and stuffy with a black or gray, you know, backdrop and our arms crossed in a traditional headshot. Just say no to that. All right. If you have a product, you also want at least 3 or more high resolution photos of products or events. If you have an event, you're going to want photos of the event in there. Okay. I will say, and then 5 is important. 5, I would just like circle. You need in that press folder videos of you, of your product, of your app, of whatever. And I tell you why. The news, and this is for news, they are very short staffed right now. So when we say take B-roll, they don't care if you take 10-second clips of your workstation, of the product on your phone. They need those videos in Dropbox because what they don't have time these days to send somebody out. And because of COVID, they're being very cautious to that. So you have to come prepared with your own videos. I did it last week. I took like 10 at my client's gala, and that's what they use for the 10 o'clock news. And I think we have one coming out tomorrow with the same videos. And then 6, you're going to want your company bio and info. This is the basis of a press kit. This is what being prepared looks like. If you have all of this in a Dropbox folder and you send this to them, they're going to be like, thank you so much for giving me everything I need. The goal is that they never have to come back to you and ask you for any information. That is the goal. If you can reach that, you're going to be on TV, radio, and magazines for a lifetime because they love you, because not everybody does this. All right, 2. Once you get prepared, you have to think, why the heck do I even want coverage? Like, what makes me interesting out of the millions of other businesses out there? And 2 ways that I think about media angles is, and I put crisis here because we're still in COVID, you know, elections was nuts. Like, we have a lot of different things going on in the news. It's a lot of violence and, you know, it's just a lot of tragedy. So craft your media angle. 1 of 2 ways is, are you the expert within some trending topic that they have going on that's relevant right now? And if so, how can you weigh in? So for example, October was, believe it or not, outside of Breast Cancer and Domestic Violence Awareness Month, was Cybersecurity Month. Had a client, we have somebody VP in tech, and I was like, yo, can you just tell me like, what were the top cyber fraud violations of, you know, 2021, and then we can send that out. And so we have 2 news stations looking at that right now because it's trending because it's a month, one of those monthly national holidays. And he's the expert that can tell us why we should care about this. It's that simple. Or do you have a positive news story for the community? So many of your stations, Good Morning Texas is great at this, NBC5, they have a whole segment called Tell Me Something Good. CW has a philanthropy segment. So if your business or your company is doing something positive in the community, they are always looking for stories like that. You just have to pitch it in a way that makes them care. You can't send them 2 pages and they're like, okay, get to the meat of it. But if you make it interesting and it's positive and they're sick of covering all of the tragedy that's really going on in the news. So a great feel-good story, news radio stations are always looking for this. And then be prepared with at least four angles. And I'm gonna show you guys an example in just a little bit where when I send stuff out, I make it like a Burger King menu. Okay, here we go, talk about food again. But I go in and I'm like, do you want to talk about this? Or we could talk about it in this way, or she can talk about this subject, or we could talk about cyber fraud with travel or cyber fraud trends for 2021. Like I give them four different angles. They come back, Leah, let's go with A. Boom, we're done. I have done the journalist and the reporter's job for them. And that makes going back on their segment or whatever that much easier because they know that I'm giving them the content that they need. When you're crafting a media angle, you have to know your media outlet or your reporter or your journalist. So you can't pitch the same angle to Good Morning Texas on the morning news that you would pitch for the 10 o'clock news. Sorry, my dog is chewing on something. So you have to research. So all of the hard stuff, you guys, is here in the beginning if you're just starting your PR journey. But once you really know your outlets, you know the different segments that they do every single day, then you can wedge your media angle right in there every single time and bingo, get booked, okay? But you can't do it and do a copy and paste format and send the same email to Good Day Fox that you just sent over to NBC5. They know that you're doing that. It ticks them off and you won't get put on. So you have to know them, love them just like you do anybody else, okay? My pro tip is that if you can provide expertise or scoop to something hot, new, or fresh for their audience, it definitely will bring you on. So sometimes what I do is I know a lot of the news outlets like to be the first to cover something. So they don't know that I've also sent it to three different other Channel 8 producers and NBC and CW and Spectrum all at the same time. But I do let them know in the email, like, this is new. No one's covered it before. Blah, blah, blah. And then they all race each other to be the first to promote it. So that's just a pro tip. I know I'm probably giving you guys too much. So for example, I'm going to breeze through these really quick because I need to get through the last couple of slides. But for example, do those annoying national holiday calendar things that everybody gets annoyed with. Like that is like your ace in the hole if you're a newbie in PR. Just find some national weird day or month that your business or brand fits in. And say, hey, it's National Cheeseburger Day tomorrow. And then make up a cheeseburger that you're going to release. I don't know. But they're always looking. And sometimes they don't even know. Like when I said, hey, you guys, did you know October was Cybersecurity Month? There was three stations that didn't. There was only one station that already covered it. They're like, oh, really? Yes, it is. And here's who can come and talk about it. Okay. So wedge yourself in to those angles with those annoying holiday calendars. They work like a charm. We use it. That's our trick when we can't find any other coverage. Do a positive spin. So when COVID first came out, a spin I had with the media is, hey, there's a bunch of local fashion designers coming together. They're designing and they're sourcing masks for our healthcare workers. And it was the first time that anybody had covered that story for the fashion designers and for masks. And we got a ton of coverage out of that. And then lastly, the statistics. So this was another one that I pitched for someone that was in mental health. It was like, you know, the statistics of people suffering from depression will rise if they're in isolation too long. So having a mental health expert go on TV or go on the radio to talk about signs that people should look for, things that they should be aware of and what they can do for mental health protection while in quarantine was a big deal before everybody started talking about it. So you have to be ahead of the curve. So you're either going to, your business or your brand is either going to be an expert. Thanks. I'm going to wrap up in a little bit. Your business or your brand is going to be an expert or you're going to just be on trend. All right. Lastly, now, once you've compiled all that, you've gotten prepared, you've packaged it all up, you found your media angle. Now you want to pitch away. Most contacts can be found online or on social media. I repeat, don't be lazy. Most of your contacts are online or on social media. A favorite database that we use as publicists is called Muckrack, MuckRack.com. If you email me, I'll send you this information. And you can look up journalists that say you find on social media, and sometimes it will tell you what other stories they are written. That way you can make sure you're pitching in the things they love to cover, all right? And then once you find their email address, most of them are on social media in the bio or LinkedIn. Send them a message on LinkedIn. They love that. Or find them on Twitter. Then personalize the email and say, you know, hey, Kathy, saw you posted XYZ on Twitter. My company does the same thing, but we do it in such and such way. Is it possible that you would, you know, like to cover what we have going on with our brand or whatever? And then they love that because it shows that you follow them and you care about the things that they've covered in the past. All right. Be prepared with multiple media angles and then get to the point. Some people send two paragraphs or three paragraphs on why they should get covered when really put it in the meat. So I had a subject line for my client that was a survivor that says, kidnapped, beaten, and survived, colon, the Angelia Dunbar story. If you heard that, who wouldn't cover that? They were like, she was kidnapped and she was beaten and she survived. And in the body, I said, it reads like a Lifetime movie. Now, did my client know I did that? No. She was just like, Leah, I've done my gala for 3 years and I've never had as much coverage. And I was like, yeah, because I told all your business. But it worked, okay? So get to the point. I got to the point in the subject line. They didn't even have to read the email, all right? Go on LinkedIn, find these journalists, pitch. And here are all your key takeaways. Get that press kit, prepare, think of those multiple angles, study your media outlets. You can get your contacts right online and then personalize that pitch. And I'm going to get out of the screen so I can take a last set of questions. I breezed through this, but I love this stuff so much and I always over prepare. Here's a freebie for you guys. It goes a little bit slower for you guys. So get my free one-page guide to free media coverage. Go to sociatap.com/the Leah Frazier and go all the way down. And it's a free one-page guide that shows you exactly what I did, but it goes a little bit slower. All right. And so I'm going to stop sharing my screen so that I can take some questions from you guys. Let's see. Okay. Thanks for all the information and great presentation. Please share some tips for a new business owner. Some PR tips is what I just presented. So just gathering all the information that you have, you need to write your bio, you need to have that, and you need to figure out what makes your business or your brand unique. So come up with, what is my story? Like, what is the story that I want the media to know? Is it why I founded my business? Is it that, you know, my customers are so amazing, or I created this hot new product in X, Y, and Z. So you've got to figure out what that story is before you kind of go through all the different tips that I gave to you guys. I hope that helps. If you need help, you can definitely reach out and I can help you craft a great story angle. I think there was a second question. I'm a master's student and planning to start a business in 2 years. What are your suggestions? Do I need to start working on gaining media attention from now itself? If you're planning to start a business, the answer is no. I would work more on your branding, but what happens if you do stellar branding, the best book for this is called brandingpays.com. It actually walks you through a branding process and helps you to fine tune your elevator pitch and your story. That's what I would spend the majority of my time if you're just in the planning phase. Getting press and media attention is, I already have it out there. It's trademarked. My social media is popping. We just need a larger audience, or we're having issues reaching our target audience. So we need to leverage the larger audiences of radio, TV, and those guys to get the product to the masses or the services to the masses. So if you're just planning, I would hold back on that until everything is completely solid. Any other questions? I know it was a lot. All right. Well, thank you guys so much. Please reach out. Go to the sociotap.com/TheLeahFrazier and reach out. And I am more than happy to answer any questions that you have and give you access to the slides, and enjoy the rest of your summit.
Hello, everybody. Good afternoon and happy National Business Women's Week. As noted, I'm VR Small. I'm the founder and CEO for the Veterans Enterprise Center. It's a national initiative, but we've launched it here in Southern Dallas, and our model facility is about a block and a half from the main VA. If you're looking to get support from us, make sure you book an appointment, and you can do that on our website at veteranwomensec.org. Now, it's also National Women's Small Business Month. And so there are an array of great programs going on throughout the DFW area, like the summit. And I have to echo Leah, that was awesome. I took some great notes for myself. And also the Veteran Women's Enterprise Center is having our fourth annual National Women's Business Week Conference, and that launches tomorrow. So when you're not here at the summit, we're going to be having our conference all day beginning at 8:30. We'll have an update from SBA. We'll be with Mr. Summerfield, who is our deputy director for the Office of Veteran Business Development. And then we'll have a policy update from Renee Johnson, who is with Public-Private Strategies. And they have been on the forefront of making sure that small businesses are getting the resources that they need. Also, our sponsors, JP Morgan Chase, 7-Eleven, Dallas ISD and Frost Bank, not only brought together the money for our 40K pitch competition, which will be going on from 12:15 to 2:15, but they are sharing their expertise through a series of critical business conversations and transformational talks. So we welcome you to go to our website or Eventbrite, connect with us at veteranwomensec.org, and join us tomorrow when you're not here. From 8:30 until 5 p.m., we will be on our platform Zoom, and we will also be streaming live. So we hope that you will be able to come out and connect with us. Again, this is the Veteran Women's Enterprise Center. We empower entrepreneur women associated with the military to scale for success. And that includes, of course, veterans, active duty, reservists, and military spouse. And we're looking forward to getting connected to you.
Thank you, VR. It was great to learn about the Women Veterans Enterprise Center. Hi, everyone. I am Catherine Callender, Assistant Director of Alumni Relations for the Jindal School of Management, or JSOM for short. In my role at JSOM, I'm dedicated to keeping our 50,000 JSOM alumni connected to the Jindal School and UT Dallas. Our alumni relations team strives to provide meaningful programs, events, and activities to engage alumni with each other in the Jindal School, as well as educate and encourage future alumni. I am so excited to welcome our keynote for today, but first, let's learn a bit more about her.
Trisha Cunningham is president and CEO of the North Texas Food Bank, a $200 million nonprofit food logistics organization focused on eradicating hunger in a 13-county area. Cunningham, along with 200 employees, tens of thousands of volunteers, and more than 260 feeding network partners, work to provide access to nutritious food for 800,000 working poor children and senior adults. In the most recent year, the team provided access to nearly 126 million meals as they served on the front line of the pandemic to meet the surge of economic-related needs. North Texas Food Bank exceeded their 92 million meal goal 5 years early.
Wow, what an incredible service North Texas Food Bank has provided to our community. Let's give a round of virtual applause in the chat to welcome Trisha Cunningham.
Excellent. Well, it's exciting to be here, you know, just to be able to come to the Women's Summit. Certainly women and girls, it's been sort of a passion of mine in addition to the food bank for many years, for my years that I was at TI, as well as now continuing on. So, you know, I think it's important that we all lift each other up and we help each other.
Great. Yes. Well, I will see you back here for Q&A at the end of your talk, and I'll let you take it from here.
Well, great. Thank you so much. Well, good afternoon, everyone. It is a delight truly to be here with you today. And just thank you so much for having me here. UTA Dallas has been an incredible partner of the North Texas Food Bank. We distribute food there. They certainly send volunteers here. And, you know, you're just such wonderful women entrepreneurs and leaders and innovators. And I'm just grateful for the opportunity to not only share a little bit more about the food bank, but also about a few of the things that I've learned during the pandemic as well, because it certainly has been a wild ride over the past 18 months, but we couldn't have done what we do without the support of you and our community overall. We really had to rethink everything that we did as a food bank and think, how could we do it better and what could we do better overall? And so hopefully we're going to start seeing the needs of the pandemic start to recede. I know that we're going to continue to have hungry neighbors for many years to come. So I just want to thank you for participating today and being a part of this. But, you know, a little bit of background on me as well. I did spend 30 years at Texas Instruments before I came to the North Texas Food Bank. And obviously there was a strong connection between UT Dallas and TI, with us both having the same founders overall. Plus, I was actually involved on the advisory council for the Institute for Innovation and Entrepreneurship whenever I was at TI. And then even now in my role here at the North Texas Food Bank, I consider myself a bit of a governance wonk. I sort of really love a board governance and making sure that we do things the right way, not only on the corporate governance side, but also on the nonprofit governance side as well. So it's really important to me to try to understand how we can make nonprofits stronger. And I'm a unpaid faculty member in the Institute for Innovation, I'm sorry, in the Institute for Excellence in Corporate Governance in their Nonprofit Management Certificate Program. So if any of you are interested in that, you can look that up on UTD's website as well. So let's talk a little bit about the food bank. We'll get going with that. I'm hoping many of you have been out to the food bank. If you have, you've seen this visual here outside the front of our facility. And this is the Perot Family Campus. We moved here from South Dallas in August of 2018. It's a 230,000 square foot warehouse and logistics distribution center. We do have our offices here as well. But this X out front, many of you may not know, even if you've been here, the story of this. Lulu Mae Perot lived in Texarkana with her family, and her children were the late Ross Perot and Betty Perot. And Betty was one of the initial board members of the North Texas Food Bank. But during the Great Depression, there used to be a sign that the passersby would put on the curb of houses that would, if they went to the back door, they would provide them food, and they would put an X on the curb. And Ross one day asked his mom, said, "Hey, Mom, you want me to wash that off the curb?" And he said, "No, no, no." He said, "These are people that are just like us. They're just a little down on our luck." And that's what we've seen in our community. And I can tell you, every day whenever I came in and I looked at that X out in front of our building, I thought, how poignant. You know, we're at a time of crisis here in our community like we've never seen before. And to know that this is an inspiration for so many and just provide hope for those that have never needed charitable food assistance before, this has just been a remarkable reminder to us of why we do what we do. We're there for those people in our community who are just like us, just a little down on our luck, because so many people think that we just serve the homeless population, and we do, but it's actually less than 5% of who we serve. 95% of who we serve are the working poor. So, you know, we've been, actually, this is our anniversary year. We've been in business since 1982. And since that time, we have distributed more than 1 billion pounds of food. And I want to talk about this. You know, the North Texas Food Bank has fed people and nourished hope for nearly 40 years. And I really want to talk about that word nourished, because that's so important to us. Over 92% of the food that we distribute is nutritious. Yes, we do get other things that are donated that are not nutritious, but we really do focus on trying to ensure that we get donated food product, as well as all the food that we purchase, is nutritious, because people that are cutting corners, oftentimes they will make bad decisions on nutritious elements. And it's really important to make sure that the food that we're giving someone is going to help them long term and not hurt them long term as well. It's about making sure that we help our neighbors get back on their feet and they can regain their self-sufficiency. So before the pandemic, we really had some of the lowest food insecurity rates that we've ever had in our community. But now fast forward to where we are, and we actually took about a 10-year step backwards to where we are, because every state across the United States was impacted by this issue of hunger. Every zip code, people that had never needed food assistance before needed food assistance. And thankfully, our network of food banks across the country and our feeding networks were there to be able to help people. Today, we have about 800,000 people in North Texas who are projected to be hungry. That's about 15.4%, as you can see from the slide. One of the things that's really surprising to people, though, is if you look at our 13 counties that we serve here in North Texas, out of the 200 food bank members of Feeding America, which we are a member of, we have the sixth highest number of individuals that are food insecure in the entire country, right here in our service area in North Texas. Dallas County has the fifth highest projected number of people living in very low food insecurity in the entire country. Out of all the counties in the entire country, Dallas County has that. And out of our 13 counties, Collin County has the second highest number of people in our 13 counties that are food insecure. You know, and this is just unacceptable. That should not be happening right here in North Texas, because what we saw is that the pandemic not only exposed hunger that was already in our community, but it also created more hunger as well. Okay, there we go. Oops, I'm going to go back. There we go. So who is hungry in North Texas? This includes one in six individuals, that 800,000 that I talked to you about. And nationally, it's one in eight. So we are a much higher food insecurity here in North Texas than even the entire average of the country. Insecure. And food insecurity just means that regularly, on an ongoing basis, they really don't know if they're going to have enough food to put dinner on the table. It exists in all zip codes. And I can tell you one of the highest areas of food insecurity, and since, you know, UT Dallas is hosting this, our college campuses. Many of the classmates that are there at UTD don't often have enough food to be able to know if they're going to be able to make it through the end of the month before they run out of food and resources, which is why college hunger is so important to us, because we want to make sure that those students have access to the food that they need so that they don't have to drop out of school, because we know that long term, getting that education is going to be really important to those individuals as well. We serve families, we serve senior citizens, we serve basically anyone who's hungry overall. But just think about, imagine having to make the decision whether you're going to put food on the table or take your child to the doctor if they need to go to the doctor, or even if you're a senior citizen, paying for your prescription. My 86-year-old mom lives here now, and I mean, just seeing the prescriptions that she's never had to be on before in her life that she now has to be on, it's expensive for seniors, and having to make those trade-offs is really challenging overall. So on the next slide, we're actually going to queue up a video, and this is a little bit of a what we call our mission moment to really talk about. These are some of the examples of some of the individuals that we would serve. So let's play the video.
Every day in North Texas, more than 800,000 people wake up to uncertainty. They don't know where they will find their next healthy meal. This includes one in five children. Families are forced to make difficult decisions between feeding their household and other, sometimes life-saving necessities. The COVID-19 pandemic led to a 55% increase in the number of families nationally seeking help from food banks.
Good morning, Mama.
Good morning.
Can I have cereal?
Okay, go sit down.
Breakfast.
Of
Don't worry. I just wasn't hungry this morning. Big bite. You want some milk? Oh, I think that's the bus. Come on, let's get ready. Bye, love you. Be careful.
North Texas Food Bank provides healthy food to neighbors in need through a feeding network of partner agencies across 13 counties. Thanks to a caring community, we provide food for today and hope for tomorrow. Transforming lives across North Texas. Join us. Visit ntfb.org/nourishnorthtexas.
Well, thank you so much for listening to that video and just a little bit about those that we serve. You know, many of those that we serve are actually single moms with children, and they are trying to work and they're trying to go and make things better for their families. But oftentimes it's hard for them to be able to get the kinds of resources that they need working and take care of their family and putting food on the table. And so, you know, that is obviously was a fictitious person, but it's not so uncommon. I mean, this is a real story for so many in our community. And I spoke earlier about the fact that you find hunger on college campuses. And because of that, it's really important that we work with colleges and universities. We have partnerships with most all the campuses in our area here in DFW. And here in particular at UT Dallas, we have the Comet Cupboard, and it is run by many of our students that are at UT Dallas. They've been providing services since 2012, and they recently came on board with us as a partner agency, an official partner agency. We started doing some food distributions back with mobile distributions in summer of 2020, and then they're now able to access food from the North Texas Food Bank to be able to be part of what we're calling our progressive growth model, which I'll talk a little bit about more later, but it's really a strategic way and try how we're trying to address hunger based upon what the needs are in the community as well. And, you know, here on the slide, there's a quote from a student that was provided to us by our contact there in UT Dallas. And, you know, it's just comforting to know that we're able to provide that food that's going to help those students thrive and be successful and to be able to help those that are trying to care for the students, help them to help the students as well by making sure that they have access to the type of food that they need to be successful in school. So this is probably an understatement here, but I mean, hunger is a complex issue, and it's only really become even more complex during the pandemic. And I really don't think I understood this complexity of hunger until I came to the North Texas Food Bank. You could always think, oh yes, well, everybody needs access to food. But imagine yourself really being hungry and what you have to do to try to provide for your family, and you don't have maybe a good working car, or you have to take the bus to work or take a bus to even go to the grocery store, and the additional complexities that you have whenever you're living in poverty, because hunger is a symptom of poverty. And so what we want to be able to do as our moving forward is to try to make sure that we can continue to not only solve about this hunger issue today, but also trying to keep ahead of it. You know, we said it's pervasive and it's constantly changing. Boy, did we ever have to change during the pandemic of what we were able to do. So I thought I would just sort of take some of our learnings and who we are and try to sort of move it into some leadership lessons, some things that we learned during the pandemic as well. Number one, it's about following your compass. You know, we knew who we were as a food bank. Our core competency was all about accessing and delivering food. You can see our vision there is a hunger-free, healthy North Texas. And we wanted to provide access to nutritious food. And we wanted to do that by living our core values of integrity, compassion, and collaboration. So that's how we're going to be able to do this. We could go into other areas. We were asked by other organizations when we were doing the mass distributions to see if we could sort of bring in their services, or we could do some other things through these mass distributions that we were doing. We were happy to provide the referrals and we put up these sandwich boards, but our core competency was really about accessing food, and then we could make that referral to some of these other organizations. But what I'm going to say is, you know, the reason why we can take care of families like the one that you saw in the video is because of our 200 food partners that are out in the community. They have feeding programs and food pantries where individuals can go and get additional food and assistance as well. It's a partnership between the food bank and those partnership with those pantries where 80% of the food goes through that can really help connect with those individuals in those communities. And it's important that we can try to support them as well. And so lots of times people say, oh, well, if I support the food bank, then, you know, I don't have to support my local community pantry. And that's really not accurate. I would like to say it's an and, not an or, because we may provide 80% of the food, our food out to those pantries, and we provide on average 80% of their food, but they still have that 20%. They have to cover their operating expenses. They also have the additional services that can help that individual get beyond what their issue of hunger is. But they also can't be successful if we don't have access to the food and the support that we provide them as well too. So it truly is a partnership that works really well to try to address hunger in our community overall. So we had to also integrate sort of this lesson into our daily decision. You know, we talked about our core values and how they guide us and everything in our decisions going forward. You know, when you have challenges that arise, I know that one thing I used to teach my Girl Scout troop, and it's always important to be prepared in times of crisis. Understand what your core values are, who you are as an organization, what you're not going to compromise on in order to be able to go beyond whatever that crisis issue is, because if you don't have a strong foundation in that, then you're very possibly going to go into a different direction. So this is inside our warehouse here at our Plano facility. And so every day we have to make decisions that impact the lives of thousands of people in our community. And what we try to always make sure is that we keep that person who is hungry at the center of all of our decisions, from our food sourcing to how we deliver food to our customer service. We're not always perfect. You know, no one is always perfect, but we try to listen and learn and grow and support and listen and learn and grow to try to make sure that we can be the best that we can. So my second lesson was really about trust and communication. What we found is early on in the pandemic, we had to really trust our team. I used a lot of my skills from TI on crisis management. We immediately sort of formed our crisis communications and action team, and we would go around and we had all the functional areas that were represented overall. And so we had this task force. It went from daily to every other day, to every other week, to once a month, to where we finally were able to disband the formal activities of it at the end of 2020. But it's because it sort of became a little bit more normal for us to be able to do this. But we had to learn to trust each other's areas of expertise. We had to empower and share the responsibility. We knew that there were going to things that were going to be brand new that we were going to have to to learn and do something different. I will tell you a for example there. A for example was we had to start figuring out how do we box produce and be able to get it out. Well, guess what? If you box produce, the boxes get moist and they fall apart and they collapse. So that didn't work. So we had to find new ways to be able to do that. I think one of the most important things that we can do as a leader is to hire a great team and then really entrust them to do their work. You know, it does no good to have their talent on your team if you don't allow them to be able to problem solve and to break down barriers and help though work together to be able to prioritize what we need to do. And then secondly, I think we had to build trust with our community. Not only did we need to communicate internally about what was happening and what was going on, but it was important for us to keep our community and our supporters engaged in our work and help them to understand how they could help and how could they communicate to others about what they were doing and how they could help. We had so many people that were so creative during this time just to be able to help support us. We had photographers that were doing the pictures on the doorsteps and were taking donations for the food bank and giving that to us. We had children that were doing chalk art and outside of people's homes just to try to brighten their day and were taking donations. So, you know, everyone was able to be very resourceful and, you know, they saw the problem, they wanted to help, and they figured out how they could use their talents to be able to help overall. And so we were extremely blessed by the opportunity to be able to see our community in action. And what we found is that no one wants anyone to go hungry, and they wanted to do whatever they could do. And this meant, you know, we had wonderful partnerships and relationships with our partner agencies, the member agencies. We had to listen and learn from their needs and trust them to be able to serve their community in the most appropriate way. Our donors, our board members, our volunteers, elected officials, and just the entire community. We really could not have done what we've done if we didn't have that trust with our community overall. So the third thing is, and this is really to me, I find this extremely rewarding to me because I've leveraged my network and leaned into my network. I feel like I'm continually learning, and there are so many others that are experts, and we don't have to have all the solutions. But if you have a good network, you can lean into it. So organizationally, we knew donors that had access to resources and connections that we needed. Our board, the government, we really wanted to leverage all the expertise of those organizations overall. Professionally, we tried to leverage the expertise and advice of those outside of our organization, just sort of bringing in different perspectives, sort of rethinking or strategizing. We leaned into our other food bank networks. You know, have you done produce in a different way? Well, yeah, we found out that some of them had been doing produce in a different way. And so we used that as an opportunity to change the things that we were doing. And then the other thing was, you know, we were here, we were working honestly for about 3 months. It was about 24/7. And we were here early in the morning, late in the day. We were here on the weekends. We had three shifts going here. And we just had to be able to maximize the output overall. But we were getting worn out. And so personally, we had to make sure that our team knew that we figured out pretty early on that this was going to be a long haul, and we needed to make sure that our team took a day or two off. We sort of gave them an extra day or two during the year just to take some time off. We tried to encourage them to take their earned PTO. But, you know, my family, I think, was part of my support network. And even though I was working so many hours, they were still there for me. And I knew that they were there for me. You know, my faith, I really had to lean into. And I even adopted a couple of cats during the pandemic. And, you know, just to be able to provide that additional comfort and support. So it was a nice win-win for some of those things as well. The other thing was my family were actually arms and legs for me. So they worked during the mobile distributions because we weren't having a whole lot of volunteers early on, which sort of gets me to what we were doing with our COVID response. We really went from having about 40,000 volunteers a year to nothing. So all of us, even at the food bank, we were going down and back, you know, boxing, and we were doing mobile distributions. And as I said, I brought my family out and they were doing them almost every day as well. And, you know, we were boxing up about 20,000 boxes per week, which required increased labor, not decreased labor. So we had to do some things differently. You can see that Get Shift Done was a partnership that we had in place with an organization called Shift Smart and the Communities Foundation of Texas, where it used their technology that we targeted hospitality industry workers who were out of work. Through, and they got paid through a fund through the Communities Foundations that donors contributed to be able to come in and be able to support this boxing activity because regular volunteers weren't coming in. Then additionally, we had the National Guard. We put in a star request for National Guard support, which is something we learned from other food banks in the, on the West Coast where it hit first. As we came in, they were able to access that. And we actually, I guess it was middle of September that we had our last few guard men and women that were still here saving us. They're not here anymore, but they were a lifesaver. And so we had to innovate and figure out how we could do some things differently, even just from the worker standpoint, because my board chair called me, and this is how Get Shift Done started. And he said, what's your number one need? And I said, we need help. We need volunteers. And he is an entrepreneur and innovator. And he knew this company called Shift Smart. And over a weekend, literally, it was one of those back of the napkin kind of moments. So we could not have navigated all these uncharted waters without the support of our community overall. And really, our community helps us in a few different ways. First, it's volunteering. We talked about that. We are open back up for volunteers now. So I would encourage you and your team members maybe to come out and be able to help us and volunteer. We have limited amount of people on shifts to continue to make it safe in our warehouse, but we have mobile distributions outside the warehouse as well. Donating food and funds. And so with the trust and support of the community, one of the things that we had to do, I talked about the produce, progress over perfection. We had to get things out the door because we saw the lines. I mean, last Thanksgiving, over about a year ago, you know, we fed 25,000 people in a few hours at Fair Park. I mean, that was one of our fourth or fifth distributions that we had done there, and the needs were high. And so one of the things that we're trying to do is trying to push those large scale numbers of people now back into the communities, back to those food pantries that we talked about. And the reason why we're trying to do that is to try to make sure that they can access additional services that they need now to try to help get them back on their feet overall. You know, the COVID crisis is really, nothing that we've ever seen before, not in food banking. We never expected to be on the front line of this kind of a crisis. But, you know, for those of you that may have done Strength Finders, my number one strength is competition. So it is truly in my DNA that it's not that I'm trying to beat other food banks, but what I want to do is I want to beat hunger. And so what can we do to try to do our very best to try to make sure that we have access to the resources that we need to continue to ensure that our community has the food on their table. You know, we had to stay nimble. But we also had to have a plan. And so, but we had to be able to be flexible and to be able to adjust the plan, just like you do in the business world. You may have a strategy and a plan, but something else will happen and you have to sort of divert and think about what is the current situation and how do we need to shift and how do we need to do that? And so our entire leadership team here at the food bank had to remain flexible. We had to continually learn. We had to apply best practices, all in a very dynamic environment overall. I've talked about some of these things already, about some of the things that we had to do here, but I just want to sort of think about what would you do in your business? How could you retool? How are you reacting to the current environment and situations? How do you change what you're doing now and make it even better? How can you scale it? So do you have an idea that maybe you're operating at a lower level? How do you scale that even bigger? How do you remove barriers? What are the things that you're doing today that might be considered a barrier that might help, might keep you from growing in the future? And how are you leveraging your network? I call it community support here because we couldn't have done it without that community support. But how are you leveraging your network? And how are you really making the right connections that it's going to really help you to be able to continue to thrive as well? And then finally here on this was really about celebrating the wins. How do you do this? Our team works so hard. And I would say this is the same thing in business. And this is an area that I have to work on because I'm always very future focused. I am not about here in the moment. And so sometimes I really did have to sit back and think, oh my goodness, look at what our team did working together with our community. Look at what we were able to accomplish together for North Texas, and really just sort of sit back and relax and think about that and think about what we have had accomplished that we never dreamed 2 years ago that we would be able to accomplish. As mentioned in the introduction, we had a goal of trying to get to 92 million meals by 2025. And that wasn't the full meal gap. That was just a portion of the meal gap. So what is it that we could do that's now helped us to elevate to being able to meet the needs in our community from a meal standpoint? And how do we not go back from there? here are some of the things that we did to try to support our team overall. We had board members and other individuals who sponsored meals. We made sure that we really thanked our partner network because of their critical piece. We had people that made calls, board members that made calls, handwritten notes of recognition. We talked about visibility. We had so many people that they took on additional leadership roles in areas outside of their really realm of responsibility. Our government relations lead led our partner agency mobile team for a while. And I mean, just being able to see their leadership skills applied in a different way was so impactful for our organization. People stepped up that we never even anticipated would be able to step up and really were able to lead with passion and integrity and helped us through this time as well overall. So lesson number five is focusing on the future. So we just didn't sit back as we were trying to feed everyone. Yeah, as I told you, I'm one of those people that I'm not ever satisfied. It's like, okay, so what did we learn from this? How do we do different? What do we learn? And so it's really about learning, growing, and scaling, because I don't think you can just, you know, rest on your laurels, because we still have hunger in our community. So what can we do to try to make sure that we can address some of these root cause issues of hunger? So first of all, we really wanted to take a deeper look at equity, because we knew that there are areas of high food insecurity in our community. And some of those are very much paired with racial equity as well. And, you know, that sort of came up during the pandemic as well. How are we serving those communities that already have some barriers behind them? What are we doing differently to be able to serve those communities? And so we have now a tool, we call it the Hunger Index, that's allowing us to see hunger at a zip code level. So we're using data and analytics to be able to pinpoint that and be able to find out where are there high areas of need, where there is not access to charitable food resources, and how do we try to make sure that we can try to solve that? And so that sort of leads into our progressive growth model. When we see those areas of high need without access to resources, then we can sort of take our progressive growth model, which is initially we may take a mobile pantry into that community and make sure that the need is there and established. And we would work with community members to see if there's something that we possibly could have a more permanent solution there. You could actually take UTD as an example there. We went in initially with the mobiles because we knew that there was higher need there. Well, because there was higher need, we had to break down some barriers, because we can only work with some other 501c3 organizations, which would mean like through a foundation of a university. So that was something that was a real challenge for us, because they didn't have that set up to where we could do that. We had to work together with UTD to make sure that we could put a more permanent solution in place for those students with the common cupboard. But you know what? We continued to persevere and we were able to get that accomplished overall. So now those students are benefiting as a result of that. And then whenever I talk about sort of those root cause issues of hunger, it's not just about those emergency food needs, but it's also really what we're calling hope for tomorrow. So we developed a new strategic plan during the pandemic as well. And it really talks about food for today. How are we addressing those needs today? But how are we also working to try to think about what are those things that we need to provide hope for tomorrow? How do we get people beyond their current issue of food insecurity? So imagine, as an example of this, imagine a food pantry in a hospital where patients can support their health and wellness needs as they're being dismissed, and they are able to get a food prescription from someone from the hospital to go down and get access to the food that they need to be able to help their ongoing health. And then those connections can be made to their local community pantries that can also help them as well. Or imagine a job training program where an individual may be able to receive fresh produce, or maybe a box, a food scholarship, that if they stay in that program, then we're able to help offset some of their additional needs at home so that they can stay in that program. Because we know that one of the number one reasons that students drop out of either a workforce development or a college program is because they just can't afford to stay in it because they need to work. They don't have the resources that they need. So we're looking at how do we use our core competency of food to help other organizations help their clients rise above this issue. So to fund our new strategic plan, we did launch a comprehensive campaign that's called Nourish North Texas, and it's pretty big and it's pretty bold. It's a $500 million campaign over 3 years. It actually started in July of 2020. We had sort of the first year of the pandemic, and we'll end it in June of 2023. But it includes not only $150 million in cash resources, but the $300 million that I spoke of in that donated food. And then also we want to have an endowment, which is going to help us to be able to be more sustainable going in the future, especially as it is in support of our partner agency network and their growth capacity as well. So this is sort of the follow your compass, trust and communicate, lean into your network, progress over perfection, and to focus on the future. So those are just a few of the things that we learned from our leadership lessons during the pandemic. And then there's some things that I just wanted to close. Just a little bit more of my philosophy and things that have been a guide for me. And this is just some things I learned about myself. And I've actually shared with some other women and some other leadership programs as well. But it's just really being bold. And this is something I've spoken about for many years, but I think it took on new meaning for me during the pandemic. And as you think about what I just talked about, those leadership lessons, when I talk about believing in yourself and others, oh my goodness, while we have the responsibility to hire a great team, we do have to believe in them. We have to believe in them to do their job. And it's our job as leaders to break down those barriers, prioritize, support the efforts that are made. And it was so important, I think, during our pandemic that we did believe in others. And they used those skills and they were able to use their skills in different ways that would help us out. I think, being open to new opportunities. If we get stuck in a rut and we're not open to new things, that's really going to detract from our ability to be successful, even as an individual or as an organization. It's about ensuring that we have new ways to do things. Get Shift Done would never have evolved if it weren't being open to the opportunities. The National Guard support would never have evolved if we hadn't been open to new ways of doing things. You have to be able to get out of your comfort zone a little bit as well whenever you sort of get into some of these areas, because you don't know necessarily if they're always going to work, and how do you help them to be able to be as effective as possible. Lead. You have to be a leader. If you're a leader, you have to lead. You have to make sure that you do what you can do to be able to support you and your team. But oftentimes, you need to let others lead as well. So that's the be led. You know, trust your teams, let them be the leaders that they are, and then making sure that they provide ideas, that you can provide an environment where others feel comfortable bringing forth innovative ideas and thoughts and actions, and they see that you're supportive of that as well. And so that's that lead and be led. And then finally, differentiation. And this is not only from a personal standpoint, what your core competency as a person to be able to differentiate yourself, but also I believe as an organization as well. You really, you know, if you really want to change the world or make an impact in your neighborhood, look for new ways to innovate. What's something that is, you're not going to duplicate services. We could have in our new strategic plan, we could have decided that we were going to provide our own programs that were going to address poverty, but that wasn't our core competency. Our core competency is food logistics, gathering and distributing food into our community to those that need it. There are so many other organizations that are out there that are working on some of these root cause issues of poverty that, oh my goodness, what if we were to support them and they were able to be better because we could do that? So we're differentiating, we're staying in our lane, but we all have unique talents. And so lean into how you can develop and use those unique talents and new opportunities to both be the leader that you are and the one that's also being led as well. So I'm going to open it up for Q&A here. I know that you're already being bold and you're using your efforts to grow personally and professionally. And I really do hope that this has been a benefit to you. I certainly know that the food bank here has grown and we are a better organization as a result of the pandemic. But thank you all.
Wow. Thank you, Trisha. That was really great to hear just the amazing impact that North Texas Food Bank has had on our community. And thank you so much for sharing that. We do have some questions. Mm-hmm. I'm going to kick it off with a question. Everyone else, please feel free to add your question to the comments so we can get to those. Was there ever a time in your career where you doubted yourself, and how did you overcome that specifically, you know, over this, the new challenges you faced over this past few years with the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, I think we all have doubts, right? Anytime we get into a new situation, we're going to have doubts. But you know, I came from, I call it the semiconductor chip industry, into the carrot chip industry, right? So two different kinds of chips. And I had to learn. I had to listen. I had to learn. And I had been with TI for 30 years. And so making that industry change was a bit scary. But what I had to do is it really make sure that whenever I was hiring here at the food bank, all but one of my executive team turned over in the first year. And so I had to hire new people to come in. And so we were pretty much working as a new executive team to be able to focus on this new issue, all because people had passion and they understood that this was what they wanted to do in their season of their journey, of their career as well. And I think that's what has been most interesting is if you have the right people and you have the right skills and you have the right values, you know, we've really been trying to focus on the culture here. I feel like good people can learn, and just having to give myself a little grace as I was learning, you know, I actually enjoyed throwing down my new kid card every now and then because it gave me the opportunity to ask questions rather than having to be the one to always answer questions. I was able to reframe and go back and say, well, why, how would you handle that? What is your thoughts on this? Because sometimes I didn't have all the answers. And sometimes I just had to say, you know what? I really don't know, but let me go find out. And you just have to be confident enough to be able to do that.
So a couple other questions have come in. We have, let's see, how do you personally define success in your career?
You know, that's a good question. I think different people are different. To me, success is about being satisfied and knowing you're making an impact. And it doesn't matter to me where you are in your career. And I think that's going to be defined individually for whoever it is. But for me, I have to have an opportunity where I feel like I continually can learn and that there's always something that I can do to make an impact in that role that I'm in. Go back to my journey at TI. I had five different roles. Every 5 to 6 years, I would sort of feel like, okay, I've done what I can do here. And I would start looking for what's my next opportunity. And luckily at TI, it was such a large organization that I was able to make moves inside the company that continued to expand my ability to learn and to grow and to have different challenges, because that's what keeps me motivated are the challenges and then the impact that I can make and know that I can continue to learn and grow. Whenever I feel like even here at the food bank that I feel like that I'm not able to continue to make an impact and grow, then that's where I'll look for, you know, what is my next opportunity? Unfortunately, I don't think hunger is going away anytime soon and there's a lot of innovation. So I haven't gotten bored yet, but to me, that's what success is.
Let's see, our next question. I know some of our audience are new entrepreneurs learning how to build their teams. What are your best tips for hiring the right people?
Oh, number one, it has to be, what are your core values as a person in an organization and making sure you have that alignment? To me, it's not about the diversity of thought, which you want to have there, but the baseline is if they're not aligned with your core values as an organization and a person and a company, then you're going to have some problems overall, because the basis of an organization is trust. And you have to work at that every single day. You have to continue to work at that as an organization. And if you're not aligned on the values, it's going to be very difficult to align on trust. But I will say it is important to also bring people onto your team that don't think like you, because very often we want to hire people that sort of say, oh, yes, I love that idea, or oh, yes, that's great, or that. But you've got to bring people on that are going to challenge you, that are going to bring different perspectives, because you don't want people that are just going to do everything that you want to do as a leader. You want people that are going to challenge the status quo, and they're going to have different ideas and different thoughts of how to be able to do things, because that's going to make you be stronger as a person and an organization as well.
Okay, next question. Knowing what you know now as a successful CEO, if you could go back and give yourself advice when you were just finishing college, what would it be?
I think it goes back to being bold. I think, you know, I have been extremely fortunate and blessed throughout my career. And so I'll share with you a little bit of a story here, because I could not have designed my career path. And I think that being open to new opportunities is one of the things that has to be a premise of anyone. And I think for people that are graduating college, my degree is computer information systems. So I'm basically a software engineer that I'm now you know, running the North Texas Food Bank. And even whenever I went into Texas Instruments, my job was in marketing because I actually didn't like to program. So how do I take that technical background and then how can I apply it in a different way in something that I really loved and enjoyed? And so that's what I ended up doing. And so I had to be open to those opportunities. But funny story here, whenever I was in college, I worked. You know, I came from a very middle-class family. Neither of my parents had a college education. Neither of them had a high school education. My mom went back and got her GED whenever I was in second grade. My dad went to trade school after he got out of the Army before my parents were married. And, you know, they wanted education, but their family circumstances didn't give them the opportunity to do that. But my parents, they encouraged my brother and I, and they did whatever it took to ensure that we got a bachelor's degree. We got an education. We had to get it at our local university at Murray State University, but we were able to do that. But I worked whenever I was in college, and my job in college was a new program that was on campus called American Humanics. They've renamed it now, but basically what that program was to train college students how to be executive directors in nonprofit organizations. And that was in college. And so fast forward, I typed the internship guide for that program because I was the administrative assistant. I typed the internship guide for the program, and now I've come full circle as an executive director. I actually reached out to the person who was over that program, who's since retired. And he said, I'm not surprised.
Wonderful. Well, I think we have a question that we're going to see appear on the screen.
Oh, what's the best way for us listening today to help? Well, it really goes back to the areas overall. Volunteering. I mean, come out and volunteer with us. We have wonderful opportunities for teams to come together. We have 75 opportunities per shift. We normally would be 150 in the post, you know, in the pre-pandemic era, but now we are limiting the number of people that are coming on board for us inside with a shift. We require masks, you have to wash your hands, but we get you to work, and you can see right after your shift the impact that you're making on the organization. We also have outdoor opportunities. We have our mobile pantry distributions that are out in the community, and you can help with those as well. But then also donations of money in particular, because our budget has gone up over 2.5x of what it was before the pandemic. So it's taking a lot more money because half of our budget is food purchases right now. And then also donated food. I mean, maybe you want to do a food drive, or, you know, get your organization involved in a food drive. We have virtual opportunities as well as actual opportunities, because we know a lot of times right now, not everyone's back in the office yet. And just the fact of going to the grocery and getting it and bringing in, we have virtual food drive opportunities. All this can be found on our website at ntfb.org. But those are three of the ways. And then any of you who are involved in policy or advocacy work, always continue to let your elected officials know that you support food policy issues and things that are going to make sure that we have the resources that we need here in North Texas to take care of hunger in our community.
What advice would you have for those in the audience who are working on social impact initiatives like forming their own nonprofits?
So my first one is, there's a lot of people out there that can mentor you, that can understand. But, you know, think about your business plan. What is your business plan? And one of the things that I think is extremely important, because whenever my last role at TI was Chief Citizenship Officer, and so we actually invested in nonprofits and their programs and things that were aligned with our strategy. But the thing that we did not like whenever we would see it is a new nonprofit that was being formed that duplicated services of another nonprofit in the area. So make sure your business, that you're differentiating. So it goes back to our bold, differentiate yourself. What is it that you're going to be able to uniquely do in our community to be able to meet a need that isn't being met by another organization? Because if you have a passion around something and there's another organization that's already there, maybe you should think about how do you combine efforts and really help accelerate the work that they're doing versus, because, you know, there are, I forgot how many thousand nonprofit organizations there are here in the DFW area. And I'm much more of a collaborator and cooperation and working together and how you can help sort of move that needle together. And I will tell you, the corporate supporters, that's what they want to see as well. How do you collaborate on issues to help solve problems in our community? So that would be one thing. The other thing I would say is truly go through the UT Dallas the Institute for Excellence in Corporate Governance, their nonprofit governance program. Because if you are thinking, or you're part of a nonprofit, or maybe it's a younger nonprofit that, or you're sort of in that growth mode of your nonprofit, really establishing that governance up front will make you a stronger organization. So ensuring that you have things like bylaws and term limits, and you have the right supporters, and you have those kind of structures in place will really help give you a strong foundation at the very beginning so that you don't have to go back and course correct later on.
Great. Well, that's all the questions we have for today, but I really want to thank you for your time and sharing just everything about North Texas Food Bank and all the impact you've had. I'm motivated to go out and volunteer, so I hope everyone else in the audience is as well. So thank you so much, Trisha.
Well, thanks, Catherine. It was an honor to be here, and I hope the next 2 days of the summit are full of wonderful information as well. You've got some great speakers, so I'm excited for all of you.
Great. Thank you so much. Well, that's all for the Women's Summit today. We will see you back here tomorrow for day 2. Thank you.